Hello everyone, today's video is going to be our 400k Q&A video. These are questions that you guys, the community, have asked on YouTube and on Instagram. And just a reminder, two things. Number one, we're trying to push for 10,000 followers on Instagram, so make sure you check out the link in the description down below. And the second is we still have our 20% merch discount code good until the 10th of November. And that's using code 400k at checkout. So make sure you check out our merch, make sure you check out our Instagram. Two things that we're trying to hit now. But anyways, guys, let's jump straight into it. First, we're going to go through the YouTube questions and then the Instagram questions. So first off, Cameron Kilgore asks, are there any upcoming games you are excited about? As far as tactical shooters, I think most of the games that I play have already come out, and we're just kind of waiting for them to be developed. We're talking about Hell Let Loose, Beyond the Wire, those kind of games that, you know, tactical shooters don't really have any brand new titles, at least that I think are coming out anytime soon. I know that there's Battlefield 3 Project Reality mod, which is actually pretty interesting, but that's not really a full game. As far as full AAA titles, I'm looking forward to playing Hytale, actually, which is pretty surprising, as well as Cyberpunk. So those are the two main titles that I would say are coming out, but I don't plan on really maybe doing too much of that on the channel. The next question coming from DLastMinute01, any collaboration in the future with who and what game? Let us know your future plan. So I have a couple of people that I collaborate with pretty often. I play with Moy, play with Fly, play with Cathfar. These are all great people that, you know, are within my vertical and like really easy to play with, and I really enjoy hanging out with these people. It's just really hard as a content creator sometimes, you know, organizing and scheduling things with other content creators, because everyone kind of has their own stuff going on, and it gets really hard, especially with time zones. So collaborations are usually pretty organic for me. So whether we're both on at the same time and we want to hop in, usually not too much planning, but maybe you will see something else like those Diplex Heated 100 player One Life events again. But who knows, maybe this will turn into something else. But right now we're keeping collaborations pretty low key, just hanging out and chilling with other content creators. HW Tag 2 says, what are your thoughts on Streets of Tarkov and Clean's speech about how there will be no menus eventually for Tarkov? So I haven't heard Clean's speech, so I don't really know what you're talking about there. As far as Streets of Tarkov, I think I'm really looking forward to it because I really do enjoy those maps that have a good amount of indoor and outdoor kind of environment versus like Factory or Labs, which is almost completely indoors. I absolutely hate those maps. And even Interchange, while it is bigger, does have these corridors and these hallways that kind of lock you in and prevent you from making too many flanking moves and, you know, really limit your mobility. So I really do enjoy having open space. That's kind of why Customs and Shoreline, I know so many of you hate Shoreline, that's why those are my favorite maps, is because I get a lot of freedom of mobility. And as a solo player, that's a really powerful advantage to have. Moving on to the next question, John McKenzie, what's your favorite advanced squad tactic, bounding, etc.? So I think for squad, one of the most, I guess, satisfying or rewarding tactics or strategies is being able to coordinate on the large scale, right? So no specific tactic I think I'm ever really focusing on, mainly because it's almost second nature now, you know, bounding or covering someone or pieing off doors. Like all that stuff is pretty secondary. What I get the most kick out of is the large scale strategies for a platoon to make an assault. That's why I really love invasion, attacking, commanding, because like I really love getting the armor, the mortars, the infantry, everything working together to take an objective. So that's probably my favorite, you know, I know it's not really a tactic, but my favorite kind of strategic thing that I like to do in squad or tactical shooters is organization. Another one that you see me do a lot is command in a tank. I really do love tank tactics. I think it's really fun. It's really, really high octane when you get in there, you know, a Sherman versus a Tiger and so on and so forth. You get these really, really cool moments where you do have some time to think about what you're going to do next because you're in armor, but it's still lethal. So yeah, that's what I have to say on that. Adam Conway asks, hey Karma, loving the videos and podcasts. A question for you about your new joint channel with Moydog, Command Comms. If you guys don't know, Command Comms is the new podcast that I started with Moydog. We're on Google, we're on Spotify, we're on YouTube, so check us out. That's Command Comms. We talk about tactical shooters and everything related to the genre. What do you plan on talking about next? And is there any chance of you discussing simple meta for squad and how you'd like to see it change in the future? I definitely think that we could do a full discussion on the specific meta for squad, because I know we've gone high level and talked about the general temperature or the general feeling of how squad plays right now and you know, broad things. I'd love to dial in on more specific maps and metas and how to play certain game modes and stuff like that. I think that'd be really interesting to listen to. And I think it does a great job informing the community, because that's something that squad does and all these tactical shooters really do really poorly, is they don't really disseminate information or teach players how to play that efficiently. As far as what we're talking about in next episode, we're going to be talking about squad modding. So that's going to be because we just played Okus, which is the squad mod, which is a survival mod for squad, which is really cool. If you haven't checked out Okus, make sure you check it out. I'll leave a link to it in the description down below as well. But probably squad modding. And then, yeah, sure, I'd love to jump more into the simple meta for squad. Eric Rehnquist asked, have you thought about playing DayZ or survival shooter like that? I would love to see you implement your knowledge that so many Milsims have. So here's the deal with survival shooters. I actually played a ton of survival shooters like DayZ mod, excuse me, for Arma 2. DayZ mod is pretty much what kicked me off into the whole tactical genre kind of scene, because like it was on Arma and I only knew DayZ mod. I didn't know Arma 2 is an actual game. So I just bought Arma 2 to play DayZ mod. I didn't really know what Arma was. And then I start to learn what Arma was. Then I learned about Arma 3 and I learned about Wasteland, Arma 3 Wasteland mod, which was really cool. And then Wasteland brought me to squad. So I'd have to say I have big, big thanks to DayZ mod for starting me on this journey. But as far as survival shooters at this point in time, the issue I have with them is that usually they're extremely time hungry. I can't find the time to, you know, run around and just farm some things and then maybe get shot, maybe get some good action. I don't have the free time to play survival shooters anymore and roll the dice on whether or not I'm going to have a good experience. That's the unfortunate side of it. Maybe that'll change in the future and maybe I can find a way to make it more enjoyable consistently. But it's kind of hit and miss as far as my time constraints right now. That's my thoughts on survival shooters right now. Next question coming in from Uriah Bennett. Hey, Karma, love you, Ridge. Congrats for the 400K. Thank you very much. For Q&A, how old are you and what is your favorite tactical shooter game? I'm currently 25 as of this video going up. And as far as my favorite tactical shooter game, let me think. It'd have to be Squad, then probably Hell Let Loose, Tarkov right now. Tarkov usually jumps to the top whenever there's a wipe, but like later into the wipe, it kind of trends to fall off. And then I'd say Beyond the Wire is one that I'm really excited about. It doesn't have the content there for me to play every day, but it does have the potential for me to look at it and say, this might be my new favorite tactical shooter. So those are my top four, I guess, is Squad, Escape from Tarkov, Hell Let Loose, and Beyond the Wire currently. And sometimes they move around and shift depending on how burnt out I am on a specific game. Hunter Helms asks, do you think Tarkov will add more player customization in the real game? I just feel like to be such a detailed and amazing game, we should have more control on what our PMCs and scavs look like and what they're wearing. Scavs, I don't really think we need to add personalization. But as far as PMCs, I think it's great. I think personalization in a game like Tarkov is what makes your character feel unique. It makes your guns feel unique because you can literally build your guns however you want. So I think more power for customization in Tarkov is definitely going to give you a more personal feel and get you more intimate, or I guess you could say invested into your character. And in a game like that, I think that's very important. So I hope that they work on the clothing system. I hope you can eventually customize your guns, maybe just a little bit, like outside of normal attachments. Maybe you can like etch something into the side, or maybe you can paint it a realistic way. I don't want to see tiger stripe camo in Tarkov, but I'd like to see the ability to do some limited, believable, realistic customization. Yasa Patel asked, hey, KarmaCut, thank you for making this quality content. I am motivated by you. I started out a YouTube channel and I started recording a bunch of stuff, but when it came to editing, I was very frustrated and lazy. How can I remove this demotivation? So one of the things is when you're starting out for content creation, unless you went to school or you for some reason have existing skills, you're going to be bad at almost everything, because I was self-taught. I taught myself how to do the majority of what I do, whether it be search engine optimization, editing, recording, scripting things. I learned all of it through trial and error, which is one of the harder ways to learn. So you kind of have to be aware that if you want to jump into doing this, unless you have the money and resources or, you know, people that you can have mentor you, you're going to have to figure it out on yourself. There's certain videos and guides and all this, you know, information that you can read. But when it comes down to actually practically doing it, you have to understand that you're going to be going through an evolution. And usually when most people start at things, unless they're like a prodigy or they're really talented, they have to learn. So I think the main advice I can give you in this situation is just understand that you have to have the consistency and the persistence to continue going even though you aren't the best at it right now. And that's the only way you get better, because if you just look at what you have and you say, oh, you know what, this sucks, I'm gonna quit, you're never gonna get better. So another thing that I would say, another piece of advice, is to temper your expectations and to make sure you're not like expecting your first video to be the most amazing masterpiece of content that you've ever put out. Just keep improving. That's the only thing I can tell you, because if you stop trying, then you're never gonna get there. And if you go in thinking that your first piece of content is going to get 10 million views, it's just going to dissuade you and demotivate you. Okay. So just understand you're starting from a certain point, and that if you keep on going, you will improve, and hopefully others see that, and you'll get followers and people will understand where your content is at and where it's come. Tassin Amin Kirashi asks, Squad, Tarkov, Arma 3, which one is more versatile, includes more modern era tech? Arma 3, hands down, this is because of modding. Arma 3 has modding, where Squad modding is meh, and Tarkov doesn't have modding at all. Arma 3 is versatile in the sense that the community can make whatever they want for the game. That being said, if you wanted to say what is the easiest game to get into, I'd say Squad. It kind of, you got to look at the balance of things and pick which one you want. If you really want that versatility and want to play with all the toys and have custom stuff in the game and be able to play it pretty easily, Arma 3 is the greatest platform for that, but finding a player base to play that with you is rather difficult. So give and take in certain areas, Arma 3 is the most versatile though. Hidden Play says, favorite game at the time. Like I said before, it kind of balances around between those four games. Tarkov, Beyond the Wire, Squad, and Hell Let Loose. They kind of go up and down depending on how much I've been playing them. But currently, right now at this point in time, it's Hell Let Loose and Squad, followed by Escape from Tarkov. You know, when the wipe comes, it'll get bumped up. And Beyond the Wire is definitely a fun game to play every time they update something, because they're really making big moves with that game. Can't Aim Trooper. What's up, Trooper? How did you get into Squad and stuff like this? So I mentioned this before with the survival stuff. I started out with Daisy Mod on Arma 2, and then Arma 2 led me to Arma 3 Wasteland mod, which is another mod where you have three teams and it's kind of like a free-for-all-ish. And then my friend in Arma 3 Wasteland, Termi, shout out to Termi. Termi mentioned Squad, and I looked at Squad and I was like, meh, I don't really like this. And then he got it for me for Christmas. So without Termi, this never would have happened. Termi changed my life. So I'll never forget Termi. Termi, you're the man. Thank you so much. I really appreciate you. And yeah, that's pretty much how we got into Squad, and that's how we got here. It's crazy how life works. Just the random chance of someone, you know, deciding to gift me this game. Duncan Smith asks, what are your thoughts on the controversy war games replicating, gaining influence on real world events, Fallujah? And do you think there's a line before it comes too close to reality? If you do, think there's a game that's crossed the line? So we're getting into some really interesting territory with this question here. Number one is, I think it all has to do with our value system, right? Because certain societies have different value systems. So for example, in America, we don't really care too much about violence, but sexuality is something that really is taboo to most of us. We're kind of pushing the lines recently with, you know, media and TV shows and movies, and, you know, sexuality is kind of becoming more open, where I know in Europe, it's a little bit different, right? Sexuality there is not as taboo, but it's really interesting to see what people become normalized to and how it's different in different regions or countries, because I think it definitely is depending on the media or the culture that you're brought up with. Like, if you're brought up thinking that it's normal, it's going to be normal. If you're brought up thinking that something is bad, taboo, or shouldn't be talked about, then you're going to have that reaction. The question here is there an actual benefit or cost to being normalized to certain things? So that's why you have all the studies of, like, does violence in video games promote violence in real life? Does, you know, watching sexual things as a kid mess you up in the head, right? And this is way beyond my scope of understanding or expertise. So I'm going to, you know, defer to the experts in this. So I don't really have an answer here. I'm going to say I don't know if this is good or bad. I'd have to look at the studies, but as of right now, this is where we are. I personally right now don't think it's harming me. I don't know, maybe 10 years down the line, I'll have some things I have to deal with. I don't know. I'm going to leave it to the scientists and the people doing the studies to figure out what we should be doing. Do I think there's a game that's crossed this line? I think just with any kind of art or any kind of expression, you can definitely get into regions that are kind of iffy. But like I said, this all comes down to perspective and to how you're brought up and to as far as what is good and what is bad. Like, I'm not equipped with the information to make that judgment call, I don't think. Red Clown 1 asks, what is your favorite PC game right now? Kind of covered that already. Squad, Tarkov, Hell Let Loose, and Beyond the Wire. Also, if we're talking about not tactical shooters, a couple of the PC games I have been playing right now are Valorant, League of Legends, and Legends of Runeterra. Those are three games that I've been, like, grinding the crap out of recently. I don't know, Riot has just been making really, really good games, so I've been playing those. Another thing that I am looking forward to doing that is not PC gaming is the war gaming. So 40k, I'm building up my Raven Guard successor army, so that's something we're doing in the free time as well. Takani Wolf, will you be playing with your viewers in a video? I do want to figure out how to get all my viewers into a match. I do plan on making our $5 member tier and giving them access to that. So if you're a $5 member, make sure you're in the Discord and watching the channels, because I do plan on doing a member game day or something like that. It's in the works. It's just the logistics of it require a lot of time and thinking, and there have been a lot of things that have been moving fast on the channel recently. So that's probably why you haven't seen that. So just make sure that you're keeping an eye. If you want to join these sessions, they will be open to $5 members. I know that for a fact. That's going to be happening. Ryan Larkin asks, what would you say are the similarities between Squad and Beyond the Wire? And at this point in time, which is more fun? So I think when you look at Squad and Beyond the Wire, the two things that really pop out that are similar is number one, the UI, and number two, the animations. So, and I guess kind of tied with the animations is how the game looks just graphically, because they are using the same core, the same engine. There's a lot of similarities there. Now, the UI stuff I can kind of just ignore because it's inconsequential. It doesn't really matter too much. It just reminds me of Squad. Whereas the animations and how the game looks graphically, it can be a little disappointing at times because you know you want to see something different. Or not, maybe not disappointing, maybe that's too harsh, but maybe repetitive. That being said, the gameplay itself is much different from Squad. And when you think about why you're purchasing a game, that's, you know, a good sizable portion of why you purchase a game is, does it play different? Does it play like something new? And I have to tell you definitively that Beyond the Wire does play like something new. Now, the caveat to that is that you have to play it a different way, right? So if you load into Beyond the Wire and you play it like Squad, where you just sit back and shoot people, it's gonna feel like Squad. But if you take advantage of what Beyond the Wire offers as far as the uniqueness to the game, like the charges, the melee system, then you'll really have a lot more fun and you'll understand why this is a separate game. So that's what I have to say between Squad and Beyond the Wire. I want to keep that short. But if you haven't seen the video regarding my thoughts on Beyond the Wire, I'll leave it on screen or in the description and you can check out my full review of Beyond the Wire and if you should buy it. At this point in time, what is more fun? I'd have to say Squad is a more consistent experience because it's got more content. It's a fully released game. It's more fleshed out. But Beyond the Wire will get there to some point, and it's fun to me because it offers something that no other game currently does. So different, there's no definitive answer there. I'd say you get more content and time out of Squad because it's more released, but Beyond the Wire, I think, is going to get there. Monka S, what's up? Asks, can you play Tarkov with Operator Drewski? Yeah, I'd love to play with the Interchange Goblin. I have to message him. I know everyone's been really busy. Fly hit 1 mil subs, Drewski hit 1 mil subs, and then just real life business and running our content creation channels. Like, everyone's been really busy. Q4 is usually pretty lit. But yeah, I'd love to play more Tarkov with Drewski. Captain Smash, first tactical shooter. I'd have to say my first tactical shooter ever was probably the original Insurgency. And I think that's true for a lot of people in the genre. The original Insurgency was innovative. It was, damn, that was like one of the biggest shooters on PC at one point on Steam. I think like because of all the sales that they ran, like it was such a great game. It was something new, something hardcore. And then after that, DayZ Mod, excuse me, I keep getting this mixed up. DayZ Mod was the next thing I jumped into. Bashar, from 0 to 10 videos you uploaded as an ad. So YouTube recently, I'm assuming you're asking here is why do the videos currently have a lot of ads? And the reason for that is YouTube as a platform recently has added a ton of ads to videos. Now, I leave my ad defaults to automatic just because if I were to manually place every single ad for every single video that I upload, that it's a ridiculous amount of time invested. You know, if you don't want to watch YouTube ads, I don't know, maybe get YouTube Premium or figure out a different solution. But unfortunately, like, that ads are one way that I make money. And as far as the man work that goes into manually placing ads and optimizing that, I don't have the time to go ahead and do that. So those are two reasons why you're seeing a lot of ads right now. Caden Bad Warrior asks, what's your favorite color? I'd have to say black. I know, really, really moody, really edgy, but black is probably my favorite color. James Rahman asks, where can we do events in Postscriptum, Hell at Loose, and other games? So let me think. I'm just going to shout out a couple communities, and some of these have overlaps in some games. So the communities I would look to join, and if you're looking to do events, you should probably be looking to join a community. But Squad Ops does stuff in Postscriptum. It does stuff in Squad. 7Cav does Hell at Loose. I'm sure they do other stuff. 7Cav is a huge tactical community. Team Dix, I know, is pretty big now on Hell at Loose. Those are the three major communities. And then you have a lot of other specific ones like FAT, SQD for specific games. You'd have to do a lot of research in this area. But if you're looking for a really easy, broad, you know, communities that have a lot of games that they play, I would definitely recommend 7Cav and maybe Team Dix. And oh, Easy. You should look into joining Easy. Easy does a lot of World War II stuff. So yeah, those are the communities I'll shout out for events. Noel Stefan asks, why don't you play Arma? I don't play Arma because I have a lot of hours in Arma. It's what, like a 10-year-old game at this point? It's just really old, really clunky, doesn't run well. There's a lot of things. I've gotten my fun out of Arma, and I'm ready to move on. I'm waiting for Arma 4 if they ever do, release it. But that's why I don't play Arma. It's just too clunky. And then the biggest reason why I don't play Arma is because I had a whole custom keybind set. And for those of you that do play Arma, you know how many freaking keybinds are in that game. I had a whole custom keybind set. And then when I moved or when I built my new PC, I lost it all. And I couldn't be fucked to redo all of it. Jose Cato asks, what are your absolute pet peeves when playing tactical shooters? The first one is people that don't use their microphone. Please, for the love of God, if you play any tactical shooter, use your freaking microphone. Get a microphone. I know I sometimes say typing is acceptable, but it's honestly, it really isn't. Use your microphone. The second thing is play as a team. Communicate with other people. Tell people what's going on. The whole reason why tactical shooters or platoon-wide shooters are really, really fun is because people are working together. That's the whole reason why they're fun. You take that away or you don't contribute to that, and you are actively making the game worse. So please, 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 communicate. And don't get butthurt. That's the last thing I'll tag on there. Make sure that you're an adult. Be mature. Be kind. Help others teach. If someone does something wrong, you know, you don't need to yell at them, attack them, insult them. I don't think I've ever done that on stream. I might get frustrated, but please don't attack people. You don't need to tell people to their face that they're an idiot, okay? Just help them figure it out and they'll improve it for the next time. No reason to go pissing people off. Okay asks, what is your favorite movie? Big fan of your Beyond the Wire content. My favorite movie. Oh boy, this is a really tough one. I'm trying to think. I think my favorite movie period of all time, like definitively, is probably Interstellar. I think I'd have to say that, but there's like a ton of war films that I like. It would take forever. For those of you that have been joining me for our $10 movie nights on Fridays, you guys on our $10 tier know how much I love war films, how I've seen like a ton of war and sci-fi films. That being said, if you do want to join us for a $10 member Friday night movie nights, make sure you check out the blue join button down below. That's the lieutenant tier, and we watch a movie every Friday at 6 p.m. Pacific. We all decide and watch in Discord. A lot of fun. And we've been chewing through a couple of foreign war films. I think we watched The Raid. We watched, which isn't a war film, but it's an action film. We watched The Raid. We watched My Way. And then I think last week we watched Spectral, which was a lot of fun. Clayton Bigby says, play Escape from Tarkov with Donut Operator. I definitely love to do this. I don't know too much about Donut, so I would like to, you know, research a little bit and check him out. But he does seem like a chill dude, and I know he's played with Operator Juicy before, so I think it's definitely possible. I just have to, you know, figure some things out. And like I said before, collaborations can be kind of a pain. Jonathan Cox says, I want to get into squad soon. Is there anything I should watch out for? Number one, try to join a community as soon as you can. I know Squad Ops is doing a new intro to squad class that you can check out at squadops.gg. I think the first one is set for the 11th or the 14th. I think it's set for the 14th. Anyways, go to squadops.gg, check out the calendar. We're doing an intro to squad class, which is for brand new players to tactical shooters, explains how to play squad. Or you can look at joining, you know, FAT, SQD. Those are the other two communities I really do like, so check those out. But yeah, join a community, meet people. It's a social game, okay? It's a social game. Join a community. John Carlo asks, what was your motivation / passion when you started streaming? Is it the same now? And keep up the great work, man. So let's see. When I started content creation, it was very specifically squad. I was in love with squad. I just wanted to share amazing moments that I had in this game that I loved, and it just started to catch on and people started to watch my content. That was the initial passion and motivation. I think now my passion is more broad. It's for content creation as a whole. I've become, I have started to appreciate the whole kind of career path, I guess you could say, if you want to call it a career path. But I've started to appreciate what I do as a whole. So like the thumbnail work, the business side of things, finding new content to make. I think just the greater work of everything that I'm doing now, aside from my specific love for a specific game, is what's driving me now. And I think that's kind of a good thing, because let's be real, I can't play squad for the rest of my life. So I think it's good that I was able to transfer my passion for the games particularly to a more broad kind of structure, I guess you could say. Yusek3 asks, what did you do for a living before YouTube? I worked at my university. I was in university. I didn't have a job really before jumping into content creation, which I know is pretty crazy. But yeah, I started my channel in college while I was working for UHM, like as a secretary, assistant, admin assistant, whatever you want to call it. And yeah, I was doing that job, classes and content creation. And then eventually I just looked at my life and I was like, you know what? I don't really care about college. I don't care what I'm learning. I don't want to be doing this for the rest of my life. So, doing what I'm learning about for the rest of my life. And I have something that I love, that I truly did love. And I thought there was potential in it. And I really took a big risk. I'll be real. I took a huge risk because looking back, you know, it's a pretty big jump to jump into something that my YouTube channel, which had like 3,000 subs at the time. I wouldn't recommend that the majority of people do this, but I personally knew that if I did not try this and figure it out for myself and then fail and then go back and try my college stuff, I knew that if I didn't at least try content creation, I would regret it for the rest of my life. I didn't want to wake up 20 years later and look back and go, you know, what if I really did try to become a content creator? What if I could have made it? And so I didn't want to live with that. That was something that was not acceptable to me. So I took the risk because I didn't want to live with that regret. And thankfully, you know, we're here now. It could have turned out 100 different ways, but I'm not gonna think about that too much because that's a little scary. But yeah, I'm really happy with how things have turned out. And that's pretty much what happened as far as what I did before YouTube and how we got to where we were in like, you know, a minute. Dan Tess says, what inspired you to start making YouTube content? As I mentioned before, my love for the game specifically, my love for Squad, made me share my moments because I wanted other people to see these awesome moments I was having. So my love for Squad started my content. Joven Logan asks, should I get Postscriptum or Hell Let Loose? Honestly, we just did a podcast on Command Comms. I know I'm shouting a whole bunch of stuff out, but it's all relevant. We did our recent episode on Command Comms that talks about Hell Let Loose, Postscriptum versus Squad and all that stuff. And in that discussion, we eventually kind of came to the conclusion that Hell Let Loose was going to be the winner there. Postscriptum, unfortunately, is more or less dying. And I really don't want to say that. And it hurts me to say that, but it looks like Hell Let Loose is chugging along with more and more content and more progress, especially with hinting at the Eastern Front. And Postscriptum is just on its last legs trying to get the SDK out. At least that's what it feels like. So I would have to say Hell Let Loose. Let's see here. Still Riser asks, could you do more VR? I would definitely love to do some more VR. It's just, I do get a little bit motion sick sometimes with VR, and then just the logistics of it and the space that you need. I live in an apartment, so it's kind of limited, so VR isn't the most enjoyable experience for me. But usually when I play VR, I play single player, you know, story games like the Star Wars games and stuff like that, just because it's a lot more immersive and I have a lot more fun. There's a lot less pressure and I can kind of go at my own pace. Whereas Onward is kind of like, Onward's really fun if I'm looking for an adrenaline kick, but sometimes there's a little, I'll be honest, Onward is sometimes a little bit too intense for me because it is so realistic. It's a little much for my emotions sometimes. So that's what makes it great. And I do love playing Onward in really short bursts, but on the, you know, wider scale of things, I do think VR is better for more immersive story told experiences. But if you're looking for that crazy experience, Onward is definitely something you should check out. AZ says, what were some of your biggest challenges along the way? Any things you would do differently? I would have to say the biggest challenges along the way is just looking at the mountain that I had to climb. I remember being at like 100 subscribers and going, dear Lord, I have to do this 5 more times to get to 500 and 10 more times to get to 50. Like, it was just like insane. Looking at the mountain I had to climb to get to my first 100K or even first 10,000 subscribers. It looks almost impossible when you sit back and you kind of experience it. And then you have to remember and remind yourself that every content creator before you had to go through that number grind. You can't skip. Okay, you always like numbers count up and they only go one at a time. Sometimes they come really fast, sometimes they come really slow, but every content creator has to do that grind. So it's really, 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 really comforting to know that other content creators have been where I've been and everyone of them has to have gone through what I've gone through. So that's what kind of gave me the resolve to continue. Any things I would have done differently? I think I would have liked to be a little bit more personal, a little bit more early on. I try to keep my private things private, my public life separated, just because I want to have that comfort of like being able to chill in my own time and not have my real life or my personal life involved in my channel. So there's a really difficult balance. And that's also kind of a challenge of like letting you guys get to know me while keeping drama and just personal things personal? Because I know a lot of content creators can go in either route here, and I've seen the bigger content creators that go in and like expose everything about their life and they talk about it, and it creates a really strong bond between their community and the creator. But it also means that when drama pops up, like it really pops up and it's a headache to deal with. And I don't like headaches and I don't like drama. So that's kind of why I have this more segmented or I guess compartmentalized approach to my personality and my viewers, which I do want to kind of improve on. I just have to find the right balance. And you kind of seen me, especially of streaming, start to meld that a little bit more. But yeah, thanks for the interesting question. Achyut Sharma says, congrats on 400K. Hope you reach a million soon. My question is that how can you join my squad team or ops or whatever I play? So those of you guys that have been on the channel for quite some time know that the squad ops servers are pretty much the only servers I play on. So you're more than likely going to see me on those servers when I'm recording or streaming. As far as joining my squad, I only do first come, first serve. I don't kick for anyone, at least not right now. And like I said before, we're looking at doing $5 member games where we take 40v40 or 50v50. We're looking at that. So if you're interested, make sure you join the Discord or check out that blue join button down below. Become a $5 member and stand by for that announcement. All right, and that's all of the YouTube questions. We're going to move on now to Instagram. So these are the questions that were done on the Instagram posts. Now, just a reminder, guys, that we are trying to hit 10K on Instagram. So if you want to help me out, check us out. Link in the description. First question from D. Kugrashov asks, why don't you take part in squad official champs? So I'm assuming you're talking about OISC or the squad championships. I don't really care for squad comp. And the main reason for that is that squad comp is all about doing whatever it takes to win. And while that's not, you know, a problem, I just don't play squad for that reason. I play squad to have fun, to have immersive moments, and to, you know, have full platoon pushes and have like all this fun stuff happen without like too much pressure. The issue is when you get into squad comp, you end up having everything in the game, no matter what it is, boiled down to its lowest denominator so that you can get the biggest advantage. Whether that's killing all your graphics, removing your shadows, removing the shrubbery, adding filters on to, you know, jack up the contrast so you can see through the fog and see further, or, you know, coming out with these most meta strategies where you use specific kits, specific weapons, and you can only do that or you're, you know, behind by at a disadvantage. I'm not down for that. Not in squad. I don't think squad is built for it. I don't think it's fun to play it that way. I have nothing against the individuals that choose to play it that way. If you have fun doing that, then go for it. But I personally don't think that's where squad shines. I don't necessarily think that it's the most fun that most people get out of the game. I think that other games definitely do competitive better, you know, StarCraft, League of Legends, CSGO, Valorant, and these are all games that when you look at how people try to get advantages, the game is built for everything to be boiled down, right? Graphics are low, it's easy to see stuff. There's a very big difference, right? This is why you don't see competitive Arma or any other really competitive shooter. While certain games can have competitive scenes, they will never grow bigger than those scenes just because the games aren't developed with competition in mind. That's not to say that the scenes can't thrive. That's just saying that they won't ever go mainstream for that reason. The games aren't built for it. While you can do anything competitively, like you can do Minecraft competitively, it doesn't really catch on. I don't think it's necessarily the strength of the game. Hans asks, why did you stop posting Escape from Tarkov videos? I love the full edition playthrough. I just get burnt out of playing Tarkov late wipe. It's just not too much fun for me. That being said, the next wipe will bring back Tarkov stuff. I'd love to play more Tarkov. It's just that I get burnt out of games and I don't upload stuff I don't want to play because if I don't have fun, you're not going to have fun watching it. That's the plain, you know, reason for it. Zorana Swift Edom, I don't even know how you say this name. Why do you like this type of game, and what game made you go deep into this style of game? So I guess we've already covered like where I got started as far as the games. But as far as why I like this game, and we touched on this briefly when I talked about the comp, is because you have 50 people using their microphone to get something accomplished, and you have the freedom to do or to choose certain tactics and try out new things. I think that's definitely where the strength of these 50 versus 50 platoon wide shooters stands. And even Tarkov, having the freedom to execute tactical maneuvers at your own discretion, right? Because you have no time limit. There's no like you have to get X amount of kills like in Call of Duty or Battlefield. It's kind of like an open sandbox. I really enjoy that feel. So that's something that I really do like. And that's why I love commanding, because I love coming up with new strategies for the platoon. And that's why I like, you know, the communication between all the nets, all the assets, combined arm stuff. Like, that's really, really, really what I like about these games is the freedom, the control, the different assets that you get to use. It's a lot of fun, a lot of fun. Ahmad Zishan asks, why don't you stream and play PUBG and COD Warzone? I don't really care for Battle Royale anymore. I used to, when it first popped off, when PUBG popped off, I did have fun with it. But just at this point, it feels like the whole zombie open world survival thing where they like kind of just beat it over the head over and over and over again. And we're just beating this dead horse and people are just cranking out these games. And it's just, it got old. It got old. It wasn't anything new, anything fresh. I mean, COD's been the same COD for a long time now. The Warzone is cool. Cool. It looks good. But it's just, I don't have fun playing Battle Royales anymore. Not really. The Lone Wolf 1 asks, can you make a video about random challenges you do in Tarkov, like one mag only or get melee kills? I think that would be a lot of fun. That's not really what I find fun. I don't really like challenging myself with these silly challenges or artificial challenges outside of, you know, what the game is already restricting you to, just because I feel like it's a little gimmicky, and that's not why I play the games. I play the games because I like positional plays, I like tactics, I like strategies, and just, like, I don't like artificially handicapping myself because it's just not fun for me. Winslow Mandrake, thank you so much for asking a question. How do you get ants out of your keyboard? Nice meme. So for those of you that don't know, the ants in the keyboard thing is for the OGs. When I lived back in Hawaii, when I was going to UHM, I had ants in my keyboard, fire ants, and it was just a pain. They would always come back. I think they liked the structure of it and they would like nest in there. It was just a pain. I tried everything from, you know, laying ant traps to freezing the keyboard. It was just it was rough. How do you get ants out of the keyboard? Honestly, it would be buying those tiny little gel traps. Those work the best. Levy Bronger asks, if you had to spend a day with any historic general, who would it be? I charge with you in Beyond the Wire. Congrats on 400k. Thanks, brother. I'd have to say General Mattis. I know he's still living right now, so I don't know if you want specifically dead people, but I think General Mattis commands a lot of respect. I think he's got integrity. I really do think he's a model of sorts. So General Mattis for sure. Aiden O'Neill asks, what do you look forward to in the coming squad updates and the future updates? Honestly, I just want them to improve squad SDK implementation. So squad modding, that's it. Because I have a lot of stuff I want to do in my mod, and that's all I want. If I can have the, you know, ability to customize or create content through modding, then I'll be able to have whatever I want, right? So that's kind of the biggest thing that squad can kind of release for me, is better SDK implementation and support. Pontus Blix asks, why don't you play as much Tarkov, you wackadoodle? Pretty much same thing as before. Kind of just got burnt out. Didn't really enjoy it too much. I really do enjoy early wipe Tarkov. Late game grinding is not really my thing. What TF Don't Follow asks, what is your most fond video game memory? Oh God, there's so many because I play so many video games. I'd have to say just like, honestly, one of the most fun memories that I ever have is playing the original Destiny on Xbox. And just having fun with my friends and laughing. I remember just laughing my ass off because so many of my friends were so funny. And it was just such a good time. I think Destiny on Xbox was probably one of the best gaming periods of my life. As far as just casual fun, no pressure, and just, you know, really enjoyable time. Carloso asked, did you quit EFT? Just taking a break from it until the wipe. Owen Gibbs 1357 asks, what is your opinion on squad ever coming to console? I don't think it'll ever happen just because of optimization constraints. I don't know. I could be wrong, but I don't think it's coming to console in any time in the short future. Nico asks, what do you think the future holds for squad? I think just wrapping up a couple of, you know, faction stuff and other content maps and stuff like that. But like I said before, I think the power is in the SDK and in modding. If they can just get that to a point where it's really easy to mod and really easy to play mods, the community will come up with an unbelievable amount of free content. So that's where I think the future is for squad. Mitch Ray asks, where do you see the future of squad going? Is it slowly going to transform into Project Reality 2 with more vehicles, such including heavy lift helicopters that carry two squads, double the supply, support vehicles such as attack birds, etc., Hinds, little birds? I don't think that squad officially is going to add any more air vehicles aside from more transport vehicles. So I don't think we're going to see CAS or anything like that. But I do think, like I said before, modding is the future. If people can mod, then you can mod in an Apache. There was an Apache mod for squad earlier on. So modding, like I said before, is the future for squad. You can have anything you want with modding. They just need to make it in a, you know, and expose enough of the game that modding can really be pushed to its limit. Cole asks, hey buddy, congrats on the mark. Right now, squad is kind of a closed community with it only PC boys with access. So what do you think about console release, more arcade, similar modes to attract more players, and a little variety to the game? Like I said before, I don't see it coming to console anytime soon. As far as greater access, I think Squad needs to work on its accessibility and the teaching of information, because I think that's one of the most daunting things with Escape from Tarkov and with Squad, is that to learn the game, most of it is trial and error, because there's no real tutorial. I mean, Squad kind of has a tutorial, but it's more of just like information thrown at you, and it's like drinking water through a fire hose. So I think they need to find like better singular tutorials that teach you specific things rather than just pouring everything on you, because that's almost not effective. It's great for people to go back and look and kind of read what they want to read eventually later on when they want to learn it. But when you have a new player jump in there and they jump into the tutorial, it's way too much information for your brain to even comprehend. So I think better tutorials for all the tactical shooters is better in general. And then optimization. Because if optimization gets to a good point, then it means that maybe we can see these on consoles. But these games are really hard to run on PC even. So that's kind of why I don't see it coming to console. Discs asks, what are your thoughts on Beyond the Wire and Squad in the next year? I think Squad is going to just focus on releasing the SDK, and that's great, and it's going to be a solid game at full release. And Beyond the Wire is just working on implementing more and more features, and I think every installment of updates that Beyond the Wire puts out is going to be pretty interesting, and that you should keep your eye on Beyond the Wire. So that's where my thoughts are on both those games right now. Blake asks, what is your goal for next year? Where do you see yourself in 5 years? Love the content and keep up the hard work. I'd love to see myself at 500k, and you know, I'm pretty happy with where I am right now. Like, I am very happy. I think I'm established. I've made a name for myself. Everything's more stable now. I don't really have to worry about, you know, the grind to get there. I think that kind of fear or that drive has subsided a little bit with my growth. And that's really comforting to know, is that that stability and that security, I guess you could say, is somewhat attained. And that was something that I remember grinding to. And the fear of like, oh God, well, if I don't make it as a content creator, I feel like as of today and as of, you know, recently, I can kind of say, you know, I made it. I'm a content creator. I have to worry about, you know, not making it anymore. I feel much more solid and secure than I was a year ago. So I guess the goal for next year is to just keep it up and grow the channel. I'm pretty happy with where I am right now. Daniel says, where do you see your channel and yourself in the future? Like I said before, pretty happy with where I am now. I'd say the only thing that I want to add on in the future is maybe additional channels and maybe branch out into variety or share other things in my life that I like doing, like whether it be 40K or whether it be board games or, you know, other variety games like League of Legends stuff. I'd like to expand my content creation, but otherwise for the main channel, the tactical channel, I'm very happy and I just want to see it continue to slowly grow and, you know, hold steady. Richard Chipper, the homeboy, asks, what are your professional goals? What do you hope to have accomplished in 5-10 years? It's so funny how you guys are all asking kind of roughly the same questions. But generally, like I said before, just keeping the channel growing, expanding to more things in the future. That's pretty much where I'm at right now. Caden Dobie asks, what was your most influential game for starting a YouTube channel? I'd have to say it was Destiny, the original Destiny on Xbox. That's when I started content creation. And then I took a break and then I eventually got into Arma 2 DayZ mod. But I'd have to say that in the beginning, it was Destiny on Xbox, because I made a whole bunch of Destiny original videos that were like explaining guides and stuff like that. And I got like multiple thousands of views on those videos. And those showed me, that initial channel showed me, hey, I actually have a talent here and I can get views. And then eventually I just stopped doing Destiny because I stopped playing Destiny. But I knew that in the back of my head after doing that Destiny run before any tactical shooter stuff, that I had something. I had some talent to have, you know, to get people to watch. So that was something that kind of put that in the back of my head until I came across Squad. And then that's when it was like, okay, I really want to start making content on this game. And I went full in. Redneck Ryan 96 asks, will you upload any more FOB uncut gameplay? So the issue with FOBs right now in their current meta and Squad is that they don't exist, because the commander on the other team sees your FOB and then he calls in artillery on it, and then boom, that's it. The whole thing just gets wiped off the face of the earth in like one barrage. So FOBs are in a really bad spot right now. I don't think OWI knows that, but I think it's like really, really unbalanced how commander works. And that just commander rule as a whole needs a whole rework. I don't know what they're doing, but I'm going to fix it in my mods. So it should be fun once my stuff comes out. And let me put it this way. It might not be fun, but it'll be exactly how I want it to be. So for the people that like what I like and play how I play, they're going to enjoy it. But yeah, that's my take on that. I don't want to jump too far into that. Christian Chin asks, who is your favorite YouTuber? Cheers on 400k, buddy. Thanks. So I'd have to say my favorite YouTuber right now, I've been watching a lot of Plu, who is a Valorant content creator. I don't really play any Valorant at all, but she's very entertaining to watch. I watch a lot of Destiny, the content creator, not the game, just because I think he's really interesting to watch and he's really smart. Who else do I watch on YouTube? I watch a lot of Auspect's Tactics for 40k stuff. Those are really the three channels that I've been, you know, watching a lot of recently. I don't really watch too much YouTube in my free time, but when I do, it's usually those three people. Luke P2003 asks, if you could go back and spectate one moment in history, what would it be and why? If I could go back and spectate anything, I don't really think about that. Guys, I'll be honest, like when you ask me these historic or in the past questions, I don't really think too far about the past. I'm more concerned about where we're going in the future. That's usually why I like, you know, sci-fi futuristic things a lot more, is because I like thinking about the future, not really too much about what happened in the past. The past doesn't really interest me as much as the future. It's still interesting, but yeah, I don't really give it that much thought. As far as one moment that I would like to spectate, maybe like, I don't know, honestly, watching D-Day, I think that would have been something to behold, just on the scale of it. And just that would probably be the one thing that I'd like to spectate, just the absolute craziness of it, the intensity of it. I think it'd be something to behold just because of how important that day was and how we managed to overcome it. The Spectacular Spider-Man asks, when you collabing with Savage, Actual, and Jason? It's going to be soon. I think they just got Squad Assault recently, so definitely going to try to get some games in for sure. I'm always open to it, and they've been doing a great job. If you don't know who Savage Actual is, they're doing a combat vets or special operations vets reaction channel, so definitely check out Savage Actual if you want to see that stuff. And they've done a lot of my footage, so, you know, I have to thank them for, you know, speaking kindly and being awesome on that. So definitely a cool channel. If you haven't seen Savage Actual, check them out. Glenn's Tech says, congrats, bro. You've come so far. What games or mods are you looking forward to that are coming out in the near future? Termy, this is Termy, my homeboy, my dude, my bro. Oh God, Termy. Games or mods that I'm looking forward to. My own squad mod, the Op Squad mod, is getting rehashed and reworked. So that is one of the things that I'm really looking forward to. Oh God, Termy, so good to see you. As far as games, looking forward to playing Hytale, honestly, as a chill game, and Cyberpunk. As far as tactical shooters, nothing too new coming out anytime soon. But damn, Termy, huge thanks to you. You're the MVP of this video, dude. Thank you so much, Termy. Next question is by Special K Every Day. Are you coming back to Ocus Mod Wipe Us Today? Yep, I definitely plan. Actually, as you are watching this video, which should be going up Saturday morning, it might be a little late, we are doing the Ocus launch event at 4 p.m. Pacific for Ocus. So join the Ocus Discord if you want to join us. We're going to be playing today at 4 p.m. Pacific. So yeah. 6Ozo asks, are you going to do any more Arma 3 operations? Honestly, I don't see myself jumping back into Arma 3, but there's a I'm not going to completely knock it out. There's a very slight chance, but it's very slight. Little Jello asks, when did you realize you like the content you're making right now and basically made it a job? From the start, I always loved squad and just making squad content and sharing my squad moments. I loved it and I always wanted to make it a job, but it didn't come into a realization until a little bit later, and that's when I went full in on making it a job. But I always loved making squad content because I love the game so much. Zach Dugu asks, what is your favorite non-Milsim game? I'd have to say right now it's like League of Legends for sure. I know that's like cringy to a lot of people, but League of Legends, Legends of Runeterra, those are the two non-Milsim games that I've been playing. Jay Averman 7th asks, what are your thoughts on people wanting gameplay stats on squad? I think it's fine. I think I don't really see an issue with it. I don't care personally, but I don't see it negatively affecting the game. So sure, whatever you want to do there. Matt Gasso asks, what was your favorite series you posted throughout your channel history? It'd probably have to be the Worst of Karmakut series. That was a really fun one because it was like a whole bunch of bloopers, memes, and other outtakes. We started a new highlight series, if you haven't seen it yet, which is the Karmakut experience. So that Karmakut experience number one went up recently. So if you haven't seen that highlight video, I highly recommend checking it out. It's got a new editing style on it, and I think it's one of the best, you know, highest produced videos on this channel that's like of the highlight kind of genre. So check it out for sure. Timo Bella asks, hey Karma, love the content you've been posting over the past year. From your Hell Let Loose to Escape from Tarkov, you amaze me what you can do. I hope you and everyone you love is staying safe during these times. My question is, what continues to motivate you when playing squad, and how do you motivate yourself continually playing hours upon hours of squad on stream? Thank you for reading and stay safe. Cheers. I think what motivates me to keep playing squad is the community, like hanging out with friends and playing with friends, or the mental challenges of certain rounds. So for example, the mental challenges of playing like squad invasion, I think that's really challenging to figure out how are we going to win this match. That's definitely one of the things that motivates me, is like really tricky, that mental challenge and puzzle to figure out how to win a particular invasion layer. So that's generally what keeps me playing squad and why I enjoy squad so much. Thanks for reading and stay safe. Cheers, man. Regis asks, are you going to try out DCS with Drewski and fly daily? Honestly, I don't really like flying. I don't have like an affinity for flying, so I don't see myself doing too much of that. But yeah, maybe. I don't see myself playing DCS though, honestly, because that would require me also getting a whole HOTAS system. And that's just like a pretty big investment. And I don't really like flying games that much. Travis asks, the most important question is, what is your favorite bird? I don't know, a hawk? I don't know, go America. I don't know, dude. I don't think about that. Poncho asks, do you think continuing to stream and make content on YouTube is a sustainable career path for you? And do you think that YouTube is the platform you're going to stick with regardless of the future of your content? So two-part question. Number one, I probably am going to stick with YouTube unless something better comes up, at which point I'm more than happy to switch if it makes sense for my viewers and myself. Number two, do I think making content is a sustainable path? I have no idea. That's the biggest thing about content creation, is I don't know where I'm going to be in 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, 10 years. I don't know. I'm just going to keep doing it as long as I can. And I'm going to work on diversifying my income on the way. So I have a whole bunch of ways that I'm doing that right now. And like, for example, if you guys didn't know, AWN.gg, which is our server hosting company for Squad, Postscriptum, Beyond the Wire, and all that stuff, like that's mine. Like I own AWN.gg. So I have been starting to diversify already. And the last question, Drazum asks, will there be more vehicle videos? Love the video and love your voice. Thank you so much, brother. I do appreciate that. Yeah, I do love tank commanding in Squad, in Postscriptum, in Hell Let Loose. Almost anytime I can tank command, I do enjoy doing it. So definitely going to see more tank commanding videos for sure. I just have to make sure that there's a good balance on the channel and we're not just pushing out all infantry or all vehicle videos. So just figuring out that balance, because there's so many different games I want to play now, so much different content. So it's a good problem to have, and we'll slowly figure out the right balance. But yeah, definitely want to get a whole bunch of more vehicle videos in. But that's all the video, guys. I know it's a rather long video and we've been talking for quite a while now, but thank you guys so very much for all your questions. Thank you so much for being an amazing, wholesome community. As always, guys, just a couple of announcements before we close it off here. Number one is that our 400k 20% off merch sale is still going live with code 400k, so make sure you check that out. The second is we are pushing for Instagram 10,000 followers so we can get that swipe up feature. And number three is that we are increasing our stack up charity goal from $10,000 to $20,000, and we might have a pretty interesting giveaway at $20,000 for Stack Up, which is a nonprofit veterans charity. But with that all out of the way, guys, thank you so much for watching. I really, 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 guys, I can't thank you enough. I'm so incredibly grateful for you guys. You guys have really made what I do possible, and it would not be possible without all of my viewers and supporters. So thank you guys so very much. All those links to everything relevant should be in the description down below. If I forget, I'll try to remember or remind me in the comments. But thank you so much for watching and listening. It's been a lot of fun. It's been quite a journey. I'm looking forward to pushing to 500k. We've got a lot of cool things planned on the channel. And yeah, whatever it is, guys, always feel free to leave your feedback, your comments, your suggestions, whether it's here on Discord. It really does help me out. I love to hear from you guys, and I can't thank you enough once again. Don't forget to subscribe, like the video, share it if you need to, and that's all I've got for you guys. Thank you so much for watching, and we'll be back with regular content tomorrow. Thanks so much, and see you next time.